Hello and namaste to all of you. Lots of you have been wondering, you know, why I have been insisting on herd immunity rather than lockdown. I had a very interesting conversation at a group called Coronavirus Updates, which has about 90,000 members worldwide. And I put forth my point that so far the total fatalities, including the serious and critical cases, are not even 1% of what fatalities happen usually over the period of January to March 2020. Now, let's look at the chronology. What happens typically is that there is an outbreak in Wuhan. Lots of people die because the virus has high transmissibility but low fatality. But probably the intensity of the virus in terms of fatality was also high initially. So probably the casualties were high in Wuhan. But China does a good job of containing the virus. But other countries, and including World Health Organization, has been caught napping so far when it failed to stop the airports. So thousands of people move from Wuhan to Italy, which becomes the next hotspot. And from Italy to Spain, and because of the high flux of humans across the world, which is against their natural way of living, you know, they should stay localized like all animals and birds do, or have a routine periodic migration pattern. But humans have been constantly violating, and that is why the virus spread such and became a pandemic, which WHO announced on 30th of January. Now, so far, there were other concerns as well as to why people agreed to the lockdown. One of the key concerns for example, I would support a temporary lockdown is because it allowed us to get a feel, get a hang of what it is like breathing fresh air. I just came from my gardening and from a 10-kilometer run, and I can tell you I have not felt so joyed and so blissed running in fresh air in Delhi, which is world's worst pollution hotspot. Now, my point very clearly is that so far, so good. We have had lockdowns. We have had experiences of countries like Sweden and Netherlands and even Singapore, which have not clamped and had a paralyzing lockdown like we are seeing in India, which initially was supposed to go on till April 14th, but is likely to be extended as the feelers from the health ministry here seem to suggest that if they don't lock down, then single person, every infected person will carry it to 406 other persons. That's perfectly fine. But that's exactly why I would like to play what is called shooting for the moon in the game of hearts. What we need to do right now very clearly is that we need to allow 60% of the people to carry the transmission, and so that the virus gets, you know, kind of neutralized, its fatality gets minimized. At the same time, my big worry with continuing paralyzing lockdown is that what happens to people's food supply chain? What happens to the disadvantaged sections, the underprivileged sections, the 99% of the global population who have been dispossessed of their commons or their natural resources, their forests, their rivers? Where do they get their food from? As inflation spirals, maybe some of you can throw a wad of notes and still get a few kgs of rice and vegetables. But at some point of time, 15 days down the line, everyone has to be sensitive to the fact that we may run out of food, and it may lead to food riots if we don't, if we are not very careful with the lockdown. So my suggestion, and I'm again saying that I'm not giving out a good solution. I'm saying that it is a bad solution. And as everybody who knows about the game of hearts and what shooting for the moon really means, it is a high risk solution. There will be fatalities, but we have to weigh in our options very carefully. We have to look at that this is March. Even the peak flu season, even if it gets extended to April, the virus will lose its intensity by, you know, April end. So there is no case for a paralyzing lockdown. The case is there that community must be inspired and motivated to take the best care for the infected people, especially the sick, the elderly, people with diabetes, people with hypertension disorders. But I'm not even saying that they alone are responsible for these lifestyle diseases. I'm sure they need the best of treatment, but that treatment can only come within the community frameworks, within the households, within the families. So my empathy and compassion is with every infected person, and I know that there are some very, there's lots of grief. There are lots of, cases. For example, a DJ in New York who was supposedly healthy at 39 and yet he dies. There is the British Prime Minister Boris Johnson who gets infected and he's in ICU. We don't know whether he is alive or, whether he's still, whether he's recovering. Now, my point very clearly is that at this stage, herd immunity, or rather what I would like to call as social immunity, makes far greater sense simply because the virus is already tapering off. The fatalities are tapering off. The new cases are stabilizing. At this stage, if we focus lots more and growing more food by releasing the healthy people to do good productive work, including serving the needy. So my case very clearly is that taking the social immunity route by unlocking the potential of the healthy people to serve and produce food so that we can prevent the outbreak further by building immunity, by allowing more leafy vegetables, more greens, more healthy oils. My big concern, and as I've been practicing, is that why don't we bicycle? Why do we use refined oil? Why do we use refined sugar? Why do we use synthetic milk? Now, all that is there in the diet of even the affluent class, what I call as the filthy rich. So my point is that let's bow down to nature's game plan. Let's have some humility and accept that, like we say in India, Atithi Devo Bhava, every guest is God. So coronavirus is not our enemy. Let us understand that there is a nature's game plan, that we have been doing wrong with nature. We have been doing wrong with 99% of our own human race. And with our own, we are endangering the future of our own youth and children. There has been intergenerational injustice. So my point very clearly is that weighing the pros and cons, it makes far greater sense to have much more intense isolation of the comorbid. I don't suggest COVID-19 testing because that is just throwing things out of control. More PPE, protective gear, will only increase more plastic in the ocean. Where do we have a plan to recycle all this plastic, all the masks, all the sanitizer bottles that we are going to litter around? So my point on the whole is that we need to be sane and sensible, and we need to allow the virus to pass through humanity and allow it to play out its course, and so that we are better prepared for the forthcoming permafrost viruses, which are again of our own making because of the global warming. So my point very clearly is that please, world leaders, stop the lockdown and embrace coronavirus like a good friend and allow immunity to build in through careful isolation as well as mingling of young and healthy people. Thank you so much. This is Chandra Vikash. I'm convener for GAIA, which is a Global Academy for Indigenous Activism. I'm also a chief mentor and innovation coach for GAIA Innovation Labs. I stay in Delhi National Capital Region, and this is my earnest appeal to all the world leaders to please not prolong the lockdown and be very careful with intensifying isolation as well as allowing young and healthy people to mingle. Thank you so much. Namaste and bye-bye.